हेलो, गुड मॉर्निंग एवरीबॉडी।
हाय
आई एम डॉक्टर नारायण स्वामी, प्रोफेसर सिद्धार्थ मेडिकल कॉलेज। सो बिकॉज ऑफ सम टेक्निकल प्रॉब्लम्स एंड वी ऑल्सो हैड अ कंडोलेंस मीटिंग, वी कुड नॉट स्टार्ट आवर क्लास ऑन टाइम। सो टॉपिक ऑफ डिस्कशन फॉर द डे इज डिजीजेस ऑफ द एक्सटर्नल ईयर एंड मिड ईयर। होप सो यू पीपल आर वेल वर्स्ड विद एनाटॉमी ऑफ एक्सटर्नल ईयर। माई Am I audible? Okay, to start with, AOM. As you people know, AOM is acute otitis media. Acute otitis media is inflammation of the middle ear, which is of short duration. Okay, there's one more entity called as chronic otitis media. Okay, we'll come to that later on. Acute otitis media, as a person, the definition is acute pyogenic inflammation of the middle ear cleft. Okay, it's not just limited to the middle ear, it is middle ear cleft. Middle ear cleft, as you people know, what is middle ear cleft? It involves your middle ear, mastoid, and Eustachian tube. Okay, because why am I insisting on this point is inflammation is limited to the middle ear, but however, inflammation happened from Eustachian tube. From there it went into middle ear, from there it went into the mastoid. So this is a disease of children. Of course, adults also will have acute otitis media, but more so commonly happens in children. Why? There are so many reasons which have been postulated, proposed as the reasons of more and more children getting affected. That's one of the reasons is Eustachian tube. Eustachian tube, as you people are aware from your anatomy class, it will be shorter and more horizontal when compared to that of your adults. Okay, so this facilitates easy entry of organisms from the nasopharynx into the mid-ear cleft through the Eustachian tube. Adenoids and tonsils, they also are contributing factors in acute otitis media. They act as a foci of infection or source of infection from where infection traverses across the Eustachian tube into the middle ear cleft. In addition to that, some of us have the habit of forceful blowing of the nose. Whenever there is mild congestion, either we blow the nose or we forcefully sniff the nose. Blow the nose, sniff the nose, okay. That's how it happens. Avoid forceful sniffing, avoid forceful blowing of the nose. Organisms which are associated with acute otitis media are Streptococcus pneumoniae, most common, H. influenzae, Staphylococcus pyogenes, Proteus, Bacillus, Pyocinus. Apart from latter two organisms, first three organisms are definitely common organisms which are isolated in your upper respiratory tract, which is reflected in acute otitis media also. More than 80% of cases it is Streptococcus pneumoniae. Coming to the stages of acute otitis media, it can be broadly classified according to the signs symptoms into four stages. First stage is stage of tubal occlusion. Second stage is stage of congestion. Third stage is stage of presuppuration. Four stages: stage of resolution or stage of complication. Coming to stage of tubal occlusion, as the name it suggests, the tube here means Eustachian tube. Okay, so Eustachian tube get blocked, as a result of which there can be a negative pressure which is created in the ear, which manifests in the form of oral fullness. Okay, it might also be because of congestion or collection that is happening in the middle ear, okay, which reflects in form of oral fullness, or it could be because of the negative pressure which is created within the Eustachian tube as a result of tubal occlusion. How will the baby or the child or the subject comes to you? They come with mild deafness or just some fullness in my ear. I'm not able to kivi dabba kandangide, kivi muchkondangide, or some will be more aggressive. They come and tell you that my ear is completely blocked with wax, something like that, please remove it. That's how they come. Okay, on examination tympanic membrane will be mildly retracted by virtue of negative eustachian tube, negative mid-layer pressure because of eustachian tube block. Clinical examination, you can see the retracted tympanic membrane. What are the signs of say retracted tympanic membrane? There will be absence of cone of light or distorted cone of light, followed by foreshortening of the handle of malleus, prominent anterior and posterior malleolar folds. Okay. If you do tuning fork test or pure tone audiometry in patients like this, then they will have conductive deafness. Okay. Conductive deafness, which manifests in the form of negative rhinitis, and absolute bone conduction test normal. Stage of pre-suppuration, second stage. If infection goes unabated or if infection is not controlled, then patients will have throbbing pain. Pus keeps on accumulating within the mid-layer cleft, more so in the mid-layer, which patient will perceive as throbbing pain. Throbbing is something like fluttering type of pain. They typically in local language they tell it is something like pata 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 anta odkolta ide sir kivi tumba novagta ide sir. If it is a kid which is not able to express, what will it tell? It will keep crying they can't console. So the first thing that comes to their mind whenever they think about throbbing pain in child is, what will they think about? They will think about something, some insect has gone to the ear. Then what will they do? They will go and do pour water in the ear. Okay. And then what happens? The infection, the child thing gets further exacerbated. Sometimes there can be rupture of the eardrum. So unless and until you don't see a live insect, do not put anything into the external auditory canal. That's a carryover message that you need to give even after you treat acute otitis media to the parents. Okay. So since it is pus which is accumulating, there can be features of systemic toxemia in form of fever, which can vary from mild to severe. On clinical examination, you will see, apart from distorted drum which was seen in your pre-suppurative stage, now you will see a congested drum or sometimes a bulging tympanic membrane because of the excessive formation of the pus behind the intact tympanic membrane. So it will be bulging, it will be about to rupture pre-suppuration. So we call a sign called as nipple sign, wherein you can see a white dot over the tympanic membrane. Whole of tympanic membrane is red except a part wherein it's about to rupture, only that part it will be pointed. Okay, that's called as nipple sign. The conductive deafness becomes more prominent now. This is how clinically you can see, hope so the picture is clear in your monitor, wherein the tympanic membrane you can see there is congestion. You can see a small dot in the posterior quadrant. Okay, so whole tympanic membrane is congested or red in color, and a small dot in the posterior part of the external auditory canal, in the posterior part of your tympanic membrane, which is nipple sign, wherein the tympanic membrane is about to rupture. Stage of suppuration, pain keeps on increasing. Baby is inconsolable. If it is an adult, they will tell you, I have never experienced a pain like this in my life, sir. That's how they come and tell you in your clinical practice. Excruciating pain. Okay. Toxic symptoms, fever. Okay. Very severe high grade fever. Tympanic membrane bulges, almost about to rupture or sometimes ruptures. Infection, as I told, is not limited to the mid-layer. It is through the mid-layer cleft. So infection, once it reaches the mastoid, clinical sign will be elicited in the form of mastoid tenderness, wherein you press over the posterior wall of the, over the mastoid bone, you will find patient winces in pain. That is called as mastoid tenderness. Okay. What's the next stage? If it is not treated, tympanic membrane is a very thin, delicate membrane. Okay. So it will tolerate. ತಡೆಯೋವರೆಗೂ ತಡೆಯುತ್ತೆ. ಇನ್ನೂ ಜಾಸ್ತಿ ಆಗ್ತಾ ಹೋಯಿತು ಅಂತಂದ್ರೆ ಏನು ಮಾಡುತ್ತೆ? ಇಟ್ ವಿಲ್ ಗಿವ್ ವೇ. ಟಿಂಪಾನಿಕ್ ಮೆಂಬ್ರೇನ್ ರಪ್ಚರ್ಸ್. ಇಫ್ ಇಟ್ ರೆಸಿಸ್ಟ್, ವಾಟ್ ವಿಲ್ ಹ್ಯಾಪನ್? the tympanic, the pus, it will try to go in other ways, other areas. Other areas are, it can go into the mastoid, form a mastoid abscess. If there are any dehiscences within the mastoid canal, within the middle ear cleft, like dehiscent dura, Hegman plate dehiscent, okay. So it can go breach the dura, go for result in formation of an abscess or meningitis. Okay, so sometimes it can manifest in form of facial nerve paralysis. Okay, so in case if it ruptures, then what will the baby come? What will the patient come to you? They'll come and tell you that they will start having that ear discharge, because whatever pus was getting collected within the external auditory canal now will start pouring out of the external auditory canal in the form of otoria. Initially also patients can have otoria in form of serosanginous discharge. Now they can have mucopurulent discharge, because the discharge is coming from the middle ear, which has mucoid as well as pus. So mucopus will start coming. So there can be a blood tinged ear discharge, which is pulsatile, because there is a small perforation through which so much pus comes out from the middle ear to the external auditory canal. Keep mopping, it keeps coming and getting collected, okay, in form of pulsatile mass. So this sign is called as lighthouse sign. You people might have seen lighthouse, okay. It keeps blinking. Similarly here, it keeps pulsating, pulsatile fashion. Discharge will keep coming into the external auditory canal. Clinical examination, you can see a perforation in the pars tensa. Most of the time this will be in the pars tensa. How do you manage acute otitis media? Acute otitis media can be managed by antibiotics. Commonest antibiotics which are prescribed according to the sensitivity of the local area. We know the organisms like Streptococcus pneumoniae, Staphylococcus aureus, Haemophilus influenzae, Proteus mirabilis. So similarly, our antibiotics needs to be reflected in that fashion, which is sensitivity. Commonest antibiotics prescribed are amoxicillin with clavulinic acid, amoxicillin in the dosage of 40 milligrams per kg body weight. If it is kid, in an adult, it will be 625 milligrams, combination of 500 milligrams and 125 milligrams of amoxicillin and clavulinic acid respectively. Along with this, if the patient is sensitive to antibiotics, the penicillin group of antibiotics, then go for other group of antibiotics. Other groups which are preferred will be macrolides like your azithromycin or quinolones like your ciprofloxacin, ofloxacin. Decongestants. Why you want decongestants? You want to give that, you want the activity of the middle ear cleft to reduce. So bring down the congestion that has happened within the middle ear cleft as well as in upper respiratory tract. So for that we give decongestants. Since the patient is having severe pain, analgesics in form of as simple as plain paracetamol. If it is not relieving, in adult patient go for aciclovina with paracetamol. Oral toileting to clear away all the discharges and facilitate the action of antibiotics. If it is bulging or there is an impending complication, okay, then either tympanocentesis or meningotomy. These are almost obsolete. We do very, very rarely. However, in the 20 to 30 years before, we used to do a lot of meningotomies. Why? Because they did not have that armamentarium of antibiotics that we have. We have very good antibiotics which do act swiftly and bring down the infection and inflammation with the help of decongestants. So chance of doing meningotomy is reserved only in cases of impending complications. Okay. Now, this was about acute otitis media. Now let's come slightly outside. Okay. That's your inflammation of the external artery canal. So if the infection is limited only to the external artery canal, then that's called as otitis externa, acute otitis externa. Okay, so commonest organism here, we know that external artery canal is made up of bony external artery canal and cartilaginous external artery canal. Outer part is cartilaginous, inner part is bony, and this is covered by the skin. And skin of the external artery canal here is made up of has hair follicles only in the cartilaginous part. In the bony part, it is not there. Hence, acute otitis externa most of the time is limited to only the cartilaginous part of the external artery canal. Okay, so since it is inflammation of the hair follicle of the external artery canal, so this almost resembles a furuncle in any other part of the body. However, only difference that you find here is the skin of the external artery canal is so tight, okay, it is so tight taut that patient will have so severe pain, very very severe pain. Okay, I'm sorry for the disturbance. Okay, so clinical examination, you can see a furuncle within the external artery canal. Sometimes the whole of external artery canal can be inflamed, edematous. Clinical examination, you find tragal sign positive. Tragal sign positive. How is tragal sign positive? When you press over the external artery canal, you will find patient winces in pain. That's your tragal sign positive. So how do you manage acute otitis externa? It's managed by local antibiotics as well as systemic antibiotics with supportive management. There's one more condition which is called as malignant otitis externa. Do not confuse this with malignancy. Why is it called as malignant? Because the behavior of this disease is very very severe. If not treated, if unchecked, this can have a very disastrous consequences. Hence this is called as malignant otitis externa. This is a disease of elderly and diabetics or those with immunocompromised. Organism which is isolated in malignant otitis externa is Pseudomonas aeruginosa. Pseudomonas aeruginosa. Commonest, as I told, diabetics, patient will have severe pain, patient will have ear discharge, mucopurulent ear discharge. On clinical examination, you can see a granulation tissue in the floor of the external artery canal at the junction of bony and cartilaginous part. You can see a red fleshy granular mass in the floor of the external artery canal at the junction of the cartilaginous and bony part. This is pathognomic sign of your malignant otitis externa. So any elderly patient who is a diabetic or whose immune status is less comes with very severe pain and discharge, think about malignant otitis externa also as one of the cause. Okay, however, as the name itself suggests, malignant, so it won't respond to the routine antibiotics. Okay, so we need a very higher antibiotic. Of late, malignant otitis externa is responding to only higher antibiotics, something like we go in for piperacillin with tazobactam, 4.5 grams twice daily, okay, for sometimes 7 to 10 days. That's the length of treatment that we go. Okay, why? Because we want to treat this disease medically than going for debridement. Okay, why? Because once we do surgery in cases like this, no, infection will start spreading all along the lines of drilling that we go. So more and more you do surgery, it keeps on spreading. Hence, malignant otitis externa, as much as possible, try to manage that medically with all supportive treatment, control diabetics, improve the immune status, do local debridement, give very high antibiotics with supportive management. This should come down. Just for the sake of completion, one more thing I need to add, that's exostosis and osteomas. Okay, exostosis or multiple bony swellings within the external artery canal, while osteoma is a solitary big swelling that happens in the bony part of the external artery canal. These are very benign tumors. If it is very troublesome, then management involves removal of these tumors. Okay, very rare disease. Hence, just for the sake of completion, I'm adding this. Okay, hope so. You people have followed it up. Any doubts, you can personally contact or contact through the group that we have created. Thank you, everybody.